Hello everyone and welcome to our online service for this Sunday. As you may have already been told on the sheets that we've sent out, we're having two different services over this Sunday and the next Sunday, which will be teaching services from different teachers around the world. So that's what we're going to be focusing on. We're going to play a lovely piece of music, and then after that we'll go straight into some teaching about mountains and what happens on the top of the mountains in the Bible. Let's listen to some music as we prepare to receive God's word.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
Let's open up in our Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 34. Deuteronomy 34. So if you have no clue why people are cheering right now, it's because Deuteronomy chapter 34 is the very last chapter in the book of Deuteronomy, which would be the very last chapter in the Pentateuch in the Greek, or the Torah in the Hebrew, or the law. And so has anybody who's here right now or part of our Southwest Portland campus or our internet campus who've been with us since Genesis 1:1? Am I the only one in the room? Oh, give these folks a round of applause. It's taken us about 5 years to make it through these first five books. That's amazing. I mean, you think 5 years, that's like 1,700 days of our lives have passed since in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and now we are at Deuteronomy 34. I started finding myself being really nostalgic because it's amazing how when you teach verse by verse, chapter by chapter, line upon line through the scriptures, like you change as you go. You grapple with things that you wouldn't normally grapple with. I get the pleasure of talking about things that no pastor in their right mind would want to talk about. Like, they just wouldn't choose the stuff to talk about. But now that we're drawing the life and the ministry of Moses to a close, the law to a close, I found myself just being really grateful for the journey we've been on. Because God's word is good. And God's word has an amazing ability to meet us right where we are and minister to us right where we are and bring us to the places that God wants to do a work in our lives. And so it's been a great journey through these first five books of the Bible. No, I don't want to get too nostalgic because the book of Joshua comes next, and we're five down, so we got 61 books to go if we're going to go straight through. And at the rate that we're going, that's going to take us about 61 years. So I'll be 72 when we finish. Praise the Lord. All right, you guys ready? Deuteronomy 34, verse 1 says this. It says, "Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo to the top of Pisgah, which was across from Jericho, and the Lord showed him all the land of Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the south and the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to him, 'This is the land of which I swore to give Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have caused you to see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there.'" And so what we have now is this is the last experience of the life of Moses. If you've been with us over the last number of studies, I said that, the end of Moses' life is a great example to us. Because what did Moses do? Moses, at the end of his life, right, he talked to all the people who were gonna be there when he was gone. He wrote a song, he blessed everybody, and then he went home to be with the Lord. And I think that's a great way to go out. If it's your time, you talk to the people who are going to remain when you're done. You write a little music. You pronounce some blessings. And then you go out. And so, but the last thing that God gives Moses is he brings him up to the top of this mountain. He shows him the promised land. He shows him the inheritance that God had promised, that Moses had been involved in bringing the children of Israel right up to the precipice of the promised land. And he's done that because the Lord wants Moses to see that he is faithful, even though Moses isn't getting to go into the promised land. So two things are going on here. One is we see the promise being fulfilled. And secondly, we see Moses gets an amazing view of the promise that God had made. And I think that's beautiful because even though Moses isn't allowed to go into the promised land, God wants him to experience it. I mean, for Moses, if you remember the story, Moses had been leading the children of Israel for some 40 years at this time. He was right in the middle of God's deliverance of the children of Israel from Egypt. He led them through the wilderness, through good times and bad times. But because of his failure to honor the Lord's name in front of the people, when they're at that time of strife where Moses struck the rock, Moses was not allowed to go in. But God says, look, I'm going to show it all to you. I'm going to show you the inheritance. And I love that about the Lord, because even though the Lord wasn't allowing Moses to go in, he wanted Moses to have an experience. And you can imagine Moses at the last moments of his life looking upon this land and saying, what the Lord has done. This is the land that was promised. I mean, think about it. He gets a view of all the area from north, south, east, and west. He gets to see not the totality of the land, but this huge expanse of land. And then it says in verse 4, this is the land of which I swore to give Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. Now, you got to realize, it has been hundreds of years since God made those promises. I mean, they spent 430 years in Egypt, so from the time of the death of Jacob until the time that they were delivered, that was 430 years. They spent 40 years in the wilderness, that's 470 years. You start back up. This is promises that are over 500 years old that are now about to be fulfilled. And what that reminds us of is that God's timing is always perfect, but it's often never our timing. And I think that's one of the hardest parts of life, because we have this idea of what timing should be. And what I'm always learning is that God's timing is different. His timing runs on a different timetable, and God's timing is perfect and mine never is, unfortunately. In a lot of ways, to put it into musical terms, as a musician, you realize that the drummer's job is to lock in the time, the groove, right? And as a bass player, that's my instrument of choice and passion. My job is to lock in with the drummer. Even if the drummer picks the wrong time, and I would never say a drummer ever does that. I know better than that. All the drummers are like, that's right, I got the sticks. You don't mess with that, Fusco. But wherever the drummer locks in the time, everything else falls in line. And in this way, God is like a drummer. God sets the time. And our job in life is to lock in with the time and the tempo of what God has. But I think for most of us, we spend a lot of our time resisting the time and tempo of the Lord because we have a different plan. And what happens when we begin to resist is not only, I mean, if you think about in my music analogy, if the drummer sets a tempo and everybody else in the band tries to play at a different tempo, the music just sounds terrible. That's what happens. But if you're willing to adjust and say, I'm gonna surrender to the timekeeper, you have this opportunity to make amazing things happen, although maybe different than what you have chosen. And I think most of the struggles that you and I have is that we just struggle with God's timing. And instead of embracing God's timing, we fight against it. And all we do is we create dissonance in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. See, Moses doesn't get to go in, but this is the fulfillment of a promise that we were studying in Genesis chapter 12 and 13 and 15 and 17 and 26 and 28. All these different places where these promises, I'm going to give you this home. And now Moses there is like, this is the home that I'm going to give you. But he is, of course, reminded at the end here, I have caused you to see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there. So he's reminded, he gets to see it, but he doesn't get to be a partaker of it. Now, I've been talking about this all the way along through these chapters, but I realize that there's some of you, maybe you're tuning in for the first time here. There's a number of reasons why Moses is not allowed into the promised land at this time. One of the reasons, of course, was because he did not hallow the name of God before the people. And as a leader, and I believe all of us are leaders, right? I believe that God doesn't call me as a pastor or our pastoral staff to a higher standard than he calls anybody else. I believe we're all called to grow, to progress in the things of God. We're all called to be loving and gracious and kind. We're called to be people of integrity. We're called to live lifestyles that involve worship and prayer and self-sacrificial service. You know, I think all of us are called to that, man or woman. Doesn't matter how long or short you've been in the Lord, we're all called to this standard. And part of that life of integrity is learning how to make sure that we are sharing with the world through how we live the proper translation of God into the world. How many of you have been turned off by Christianity by looking at someone who was a Christian who didn't treat people quite right? Raise your hand. Yeah, look around. And for those of you online, you're like, me too. You know? I know for me, the first hurdles that I had to deal with when Jesus was wooing me was the hurdles over people who were Christians who didn't act like Christians. And so what you realize is that your life is not lived in isolation, but your life is lived out loud and other people are reading your life. And for Moses, as the leader of the children of Israel, his role was essential to show the children of Israel, this is who the Lord is. And when he failed at that, he broke a picture that God wanted the people to have. And in the same way, when you and I don't walk in the Spirit, we don't walk simply responding to the finished work of Jesus and the prompts of the Spirit. When we don't walk in line with that, we begin to reflect the wrong image of God into the world. And so Moses did that. And there was a consequence to that. Because many people stumbled because of Moses' actions. But another reason Moses wasn't allowed to enter in was because all through the scriptures, Moses will always be a picture of the law of Sinai, the law of Moses. And there is a spiritual reality that God wanted to make sure was placed not only in the biblical story, but in all the pictures and types and shadows of the Bible, and that's the fact that the law will never get you into the promised land. That nobody by law keeping, by good works, by all sorts of acts of religion, nobody can enter the promised land by the things that they do. The Apostle Paul writes every letter based on this theme. But what's amazing is even though we have Bibles full of it, it doesn't keep us oftentimes, as for those of you who are followers of Jesus, of trying to work your way into the promised land. Where it's like you almost feel like, well, if I do this and I don't do this, then I'm going to get to where I want to be. And we end up putting our lives on like almost a spiritual hamster wheel. Where every day it's like, I have to make sure I get it right. And really what you learn is that law keeping never gets us into the promised land. But who does bring us into the promised land? Jesus. Now, who's the successor of Moses? Joshua. What's Joshua's name in Hebrew? Yahshua, which we get our word Jesus from. So all of this has to be there. Moses can only bring you to the edge of the promised land because the law is designed to be a tutor until we come to Yahshua, the Lord, God our salvation. That's what Joshua means. It means God our salvation. Yahoshua. Two words in the Hebrew slammed together. God our salvation. And so Moses was never going to be able to bring us into the promised land because that's Joshua's job. That's the Lord's job. And Joshua is a great picture of that. But again, don't miss this. I'm going to talk about this a little more in a second. Moses did make it into the promised land, didn't he? In the Mount of Transfiguration, remember that story? Where Peter, James, and John went up with Jesus onto a high mountain and Jesus' glory as God was, that was clothed in skin in the incarnation, in Jesus in flesh, when it turned outward. It's such a beautiful picture. You might not even think about it in these ways. If you remember the story of the tabernacle, right, that mobile worship tent, all of the beauty was on the inside. On the outside, it was almost covered over with waterproof skins, that it was nothing beautiful. It was totally humble on the outside. But if you walked into the tabernacle, there was all the curtains and they were embroidered and all this beautiful, the candelabra, but it was all on the inside. That's a picture too, because Jesus is the living tabernacle, the living temple. On the outside, when Jesus came, he's just a human being, just skin. But on the inside is the perfections of God. But on that Mount of Transfiguration, as we call it, Jesus's essential glory that was clothed in humble skin turned outward for a moment. And those disciples saw it. And if you recall, Moses and Elijah came and spoke to Jesus. Remember in Peter being Peter, the great encouragement for those of you who have foot and mouth disease. Right, Peter's like, Lord, it's so good that we're here. We're going to make tabernacles for you, for Moses and Elijah. And the Lord spoke, said, no, listen to my son. Like, you, buddy, shh. That's what the Lord, because I mean, I love Peter in the Bible. I think God chose Peter to be an apostle just for me. Because I'm that guy, you know. I'm like, Lord, I got this great plan. The Lord's like, shh, just listen to Jesus. You're going to be fine, you know. But it's beautiful that Moses was not allowed to go into the promised land. But because of Jesus, Moses ends up in the promised land. And you know what that speaks to? There are many of you right now who you've been caught up in works righteousness. You've been caught up in the, if I do this, then God will accept me. And there's all sorts of fringe groups that formerly called cults, now they just try and call themselves churches, where it's works righteousness. It's you have to do all these things and then God will accept you. The Bible actually teaches that you put your faith and trust in Jesus and God accepts you. And then because, amen, that's the good news. Jesus is perfect. And because we put our faith and trust in Jesus, we have been robed in his perfections. And then we live our lives differently because of who Jesus is. But we don't have to do these things so God accepts us. We do these things because we've already been accepted. So it's not like if I do this, now God's going to give me what I want. It's God has already done a work in my life. And because God has done that, I live differently because everything's different because of what God has done for me. And one, it speaks to a motivation that I have to win God over every day. I have to put God in my debt by all these good things that I do. And the other one says, I'm already in God's good graces, so I'm just dancing, so to speak, in the presence of the Lord, and I live with this joy in my heart. And because of what God has done for me, I just live differently. But you'll always know you're involved in works righteousness if your mistakes levels you spiritually. Because what you're trusting is, you're trusting in you not making the mistakes you make. Now, I'm not saying we should be light on sin. I'm not saying we should not think about these things. But the reality is that when you're motivated by the love of God, and when God's love has compelled your heart, and you know that Jesus finished the work, then you say, because of Jesus, how shall I live now? And you make different sets of decisions. So it's beautiful. Even though Moses isn't allowed to bring the children into the promised land, he still ends up in it. But because of Jesus. So if you have a background of religiosity, works righteousness, maybe you were in some sort of a church where these were the rules, you had to keep the rules, the elders told you the rules, and you made sure you kept the rules. Because that was your background doesn't mean that you don't get to go to the promised land, but you only get in because of Jesus. You put your faith and trust in Jesus. And Jesus begins to reteach you and retrain you on how to live. And I love that. Our pastor, Greg Young, who I love so much, he always says that we're all rental projects. You know, like we're all houses under construction. And it's just a matter of what part of us is under reno at any given moment. You know, and there's some of us, and I'm in that category, who grew up outside of religion. And so I had all such stuff that I did wrong. And because of that, then God's doing reno in my life. And there's others of you who grew up in legalism. You grew up in very strict non-grace-based churches, and then you come to Christ, and now the reno project's in a different area because you didn't do all those things wrong, but you have a whole other set of issues given the things that you experienced. But the reality is no matter what your history is, all of us are being renovated. And if you're here right now, whether you're in our Vancouver sanctuary or in our Southwest Portland sanctuary, whether you're online, if you don't think you need to be renovated, that is exactly where God wants to work on you. Because all of us have areas that God wants to work on because we're not perfected yet. I mean, we're perfect in Christ, but our experience of living out that perfection is in process. So we're all in the process of becoming who we really are in the finished work of Christ. Does that make sense? Now, in verse 5, we see what is commonly, it's the death of Moses. Look what it says. It says, so Moses, the servant of the Lord, died in the land of Moab according to the word of the Lord, and he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows his grave to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyes were not dim, nor his natural vigor diminished, and the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days, so the days of weeping and mourning for Moses had ended. Now, this is some very, very fascinating stuff. First, I want you to notice this in verse 5. So Moses, the servant of the Lord. That is an amazingly beautiful designation. Because if you read through the Bible, you find David was a servant of the Lord. There's a number of people who get that designation. And I want to encourage and exhort you to Live your life in such a way that when people remember you, they remember your name, the servant of the Lord. Because that is the ultimate designation. Because Jesus said, greatest in the kingdom is the servant of all, right? And so if you live your life, my only goal is to be the servant of the Lord. Whatever my Lord, whatever my master wants from me, I am here at his pleasure. If that's the only goal you have in life, then you will live a life that will be drenched with the things of God. I want you to write that down. Put your name down and say, the servant of the Lord. This is what we're going to do. All of us, I want you to say your name out loud. Ready, go. Daniel Fisker. The servant of the Lord. Say your name again, then say, the servant of the Lord. Go ahead. The servant of the Lord. I want you to get used to talking about yourself that way. Because that is who we are. We want to be the kind of people, when the Lord says, whom shall we send? We say, send me, because I am a servant of the Lord. See, I love this kind of stuff. I'm always trying to find, like, if I can, because I want to major in the majors, right? I realize life is full of distractions. There's all sorts of things I can get involved in. But I want to make sure I get the most important things down. So when I see something like this, the servant of the Lord, I'm like, I can hang my hat on that. I can live my whole life saying, I just want Daniel Fusco to be known as the servant of the Lord, right? In the same way, the idea of love. Love is the point. The art of living is loving. That's the way I like to say it, right? So it's really easy then every day. Have I loved people today? Have I loved God today, right? I don't have to worry about it. If I get that, if I get the servant of the Lord and love God and love people right, and if I do that for my whole life, guess what? I'm going to be exactly where I want to be. Not perfect, but those are the big things, right? A lot of the other things, they're peripheral stuff. So I'm always trying to break a complicated life down into very bite-sized, simple things. And I think this servant of the Lord language is important. Because if you read in your Bible, the greatest in the kingdom is a servant of the Lord. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, said he died there. So now we see Moses. We've been traveling with Moses since the book of Exodus. Now we see him, he dies. And we learn some really interesting things. Notice in verse 6, and he, capital H, buried him, lowercase h, in the valley of the land of Moab opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows his grave to this day. Who buried Moses? God buried Moses. Anybody wonder how that all works? I sure do. All we learn is that Moses was buried by God himself, and nobody knows where the grave is. Now, what's really fascinating about this is that by the time, if you fast forward to the book of Jude, that very small one-chapter book before the book of Revelation, you find in Jude verse 9 that Satan and the archangel Michael disputed over the body of Moses, and all the archangel said was, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Now, that's a very strange, you guys ever read that before? Ever wonder what it was all about? You should wonder what it's, that's an interesting thing. So there's some sort of dispute between Satan and the archangel about the body of Moses. Now, I'm going to read you a long quotation. So it's kind of dry, but I want to read you the whole quotation because I think it's very fascinating. And this comes from a book called The Legends of the Jews. Now, you realize that the Bible is God's word, but there's all sorts of other writings that go around the Bible. They're extra biblical literature, right? Some of them are books that are in the in-between periods. There's also lots of oral law or oral teaching that went along. If you were to want to study all the writings surrounding the Pentateuch, literally it would fill our entire campus with books. Because so many rabbis have written, so many, there's the Mishnah, and there's the Talmud, and there's all these different writings. And so an author named Ginsberg wrote down a lot of the kind of oral teachings, because before they wrote all this stuff down, everything was transmitted orally, and so there's all this discussion. So I'm going to read you this long passage about the death of Moses, and I think you'll see why I'm reading it to you. It says this, it says, in the meantime, Moses' time was at an end. A voice from heaven resounded, saying, why, Moses, dost thou strive in vain? Thy last second is at hand. Moses instantly stood up for prayer and said, Lord of the world, be mindful of the day on which thou didst reveal thyself to me in the bush of thorns, and be mindful also of the day when I ascended into heaven and during 40 days partook of neither food nor drink. You, gracious and merciful God, deliver me not into the hand of Satan. And God replied, I have heard thy prayer. I myself shall attend to thee and bury thee. Moses now sanctified himself, as do the seraphim that surround the divine majesty, whereupon God from the highest heavens revealed himself to receive Moses' soul. When Moses beheld the Holy One, blessed be his name, he fell upon his face and said, Lord of the world, in love you did create the world, and in love you guide it. Treat me also with love, and deliver me not into the hands of the angel of death. A heavenly voice sounded and said, Moses, be not afraid. Your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your reward. With God descended from heaven three angels, Michael, Gabriel, and Zagzagel. Gabriel arranged Moses' couch. Michael spread out it with purple garment, and Zagzagel laid down a wooden pillow. God stationed himself over Moses' head, Michael at his right, Gabriel at his left, and Zagzagel at his feet, whereupon God addressed Moses, cross thy feet. Moses did so. And then he said, fold thy hands and lay them upon thy breast. And Moses did so. Then God said, close thine eyes. And Moses did so. And then God spake to Moses in soul, my daughter, 120 years had I decreed that thou shouldest dwell in this righteous man's body, but hesitate not now to leave it, for thy time is run. I myself shall take you to the highest heavens and let you dwell under the throne of my glory. And when Moses heard these words, he permitted his soul to leave him, saying to her, return to thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with thee. God thereupon took Moses' soul by kissing him on the mouth. Now, guess what? I have no clue what that actually really means. But I did want, I want you to realize that, you know, when it just says that Moses died and God buried him, like, what exactly does that mean? And you have, this is some of the writings that surround in the folklore of Judaism on the death of Moses. Now, I just read to you, I wouldn't put any stock in it. I know what's unfortunate is I think we live in a day and age where oftentimes people are more interested in extra-biblical things than biblical things, you know, where it's so much easier to get excited about, wow, this crazy legend, and, you know, I'm not, some of you are like, wow, you know, they called Moses' soul a her. What does that mean? And you can get all interested in all these things. I wouldn't put much stock in it, but I thought it was an interesting thing as part of the folklore surrounding the death of Moses. And so you end up having Moses dying. He's buried. No one knows where he is. Now in verse 7, what we learn is that Moses was 120 years old when he dies. His eyes were not dim, nor his natural vigor diminished. Now that's fascinating, because first you know that Moses' life, 120 years, divided into three kind of distinct seasons. His first 40 years, remember, he was raised as a prince in Egypt. Pharaoh's daughter received him out of the river when they put him to die, received him, and he was raised in Pharaoh's court. But at the end of the 40 years, remember, he went out and he saw an Egyptian harassing one of his Hebrew brothers, and he killed the Egyptian and buried him, hope no one knew. But everyone found out about it, and then Moses fled. So it's almost like the first 40 years, Moses lived in privilege. He had everything somebody could want, right? And then for the next 40 years, from his 40 to he was 80, he lived in the Midian wilderness. He married Zipporah. He took care of his father-in-law Jethro's flocks, and he wandered around the desert. And you can look at it, if the first 40 years was a time of privilege, the second 40 years was a time of brokenness, where Moses, it was almost like he spent 40 years learning he was somebody, and then he spent 40 years learning he was nobody. He was just a shepherd in the world. Like, there was nobody. It was just him and sheep and his wife and his family. And there was a season of nothingness. It was a wilderness season. But God used the wilderness season so that God could use mightily on the back 40. On that last 40-year period when he went and he was God's mouthpiece, God's ambassador to Pharaoh and to the children of Israel, and led them from Egyptian bondage all the way to the precipice of the promised land. And in that season, spoke with the Lord and learned from the Lord and shared with others. And I bring this up because I think for many of us, we have a hard time discerning the seasons, and we have a hard time seeing God's purpose in the seasons. Exactly. Amen. But isn't it true? It's like many of you right now, you're going through seasons like, why? But what if every season of our life is purposeful from the Lord to work certain things into our lives that cannot be worked in any other way? See, when you get to the end of Moses' life and you look back with the hindsight, that's 2020, you begin to see God was wise with the life of Moses. You might say, well, man, that's lost 40 years in the middle. They weren't lost. God revealed himself to Moses at that burning, fiery bush in such a powerful way. So are you being faithful in the season you're in? That's the big question. Whatever the season is, are you walking faithfully? I mean, I think what happens is in seasons of privilege, we forget the Lord, and then in seasons of wilderness and brokenness, we despair in the Lord. But really, in the season of privilege, we should praise the Lord. In the season of wilderness and brokenness, we should praise the Lord. And in the seasons of much fruitfulness, we should praise the Lord. But the key is can we figure out how to do that when it's happening? It's easy after the fact, right? It's easy to be like, oh yeah, look at what God was doing. But it's in the midst of it, can we choose to be faithful? And I think that when I look at the life of Moses, I want to learn how to be faithful in whatever the seasons are. And we do learn here, of course, that Moses at 120, his eyes was not dim, so his eyesight was not weakened, and his natural vigor was not reduced. So really what this is that Moses at 120 was ready to go run an Ironman. You know, like he was ready to go. It wasn't like he was just, his body was breaking down. He had it all together, but it was his time. And the children of Israel wept for Moses for 30 days. They mourned for him because he had been their leader all this time. And now to close out this chapter, verse 9, now Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, and Moses laid his hands on him. So the children of Israel heeded him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. But since then, there has not arisen in Israel a prophet like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. In all the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt before Pharaoh, before all his servants, and in all his land, and by all that mighty power and all that great terror which Moses performed in the sight of Israel. So we learn that as Moses passes from the scene, God has a new leader, Joshua, the son of Nun. He was full of the spirit of wisdom, and Moses had laid hands on him. So there was that formal transfer of leadership from Moses to Joshua. And if you recall, Moses had discipled Joshua. Joshua was apprenticing in the things of God under Moses for many, many years. Moses allowed Joshua into what God was doing in and through his life so that Joshua could be raised up. And now it's time for Joshua to receive that leadership role that God had ordained him for. This speaks to me, of course, about discipleship. And I like to say that discipleship is somebody who is farther down the road in the things of God, inviting somebody who is not as far down the road in the things of God to sit with them in the middle of their life and see what Jesus is up to. That's what discipleship is. And we always encourage everyone to be discipled and to be someone who's pouring into other people. You are designed to learn from and to teach other people. We are all doctors and patients. We are all teachers and students. And God wants each one of us to bring people along, bring people under our wings and allow them to learn the things of God in the midst of the things that we're learning. And at the same time, to be pouring down into other people. And I want to encourage all of you to make sure that you are involved in the discipleship process. Not linking people to you, but linking people to the Lord. See, Moses, Joshua was passionate and he loved Moses, but Moses linked him to the Lord, not to Moses. And good discipleship doesn't link somebody to a person unless that person is Jesus. We see the wisdom and the testimony and the fruitfulness of Joshua's life, and you can praise God for Moses' tutelage of Joshua. And I think if you look at your life, those of you who feel like God is doing some amazing things, I guarantee there's a number of people who've been instrumental in that. Because God uses people in each one of our lives. He uses people to make investments in our lives, as Moses did to Joshua. Now, I'm going to invite the worship team to come on out as we close out the Pentateuch, the book of Deuteronomy here. It's beautiful because we find that because Moses and his investment, the children of Israel heeded Joshua. They allowed Joshua to lead them. But we're reminded in verses 10 to 12 that there has been none arose in Israel who was a prophet like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. And that was true up until the Lord Jesus came. Because Jesus was the prophesied prophet who was going to come after Moses in Deuteronomy 18. But there was unique things about Moses' life. One, this idea of the unique intimacy and personal relationship that he had with God, this idea of knowing God face to face. It was a Hebrew way of saying there was a deep intimacy between Moses and the Lord. And we saw it all the way through Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy. And all the signs and wonders. Moses was unique in the number and the kinds of miracles. Of course, this was true up until Jesus shows up, right? And Jesus is, giving sight to the blind, and he's healing lepers, and he's raising people from the dead, and all these different things are going on. So the uniqueness in the signs and wonders. And then, of course, in verse 12, by all the mighty power and all the great terror that Moses performed in the sight of Israel. They might be like, the great terror, of course, that would make you think of a lot of the plagues and the different things that went on, all the different judgments that came on the children of Israel for rebellion against the Lord and against Moses. And there's no doubt that when you think of Jesus, the terror that comes with Jesus as the judge is truly unlike anything that the Bible's ever seen. So as we bring this to a close, when I think about the life of Moses, I think that Moses, even though he was an imperfect leader, Moses lands in the hall of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. And what I want to remind you is that the only perfect person is Jesus, but we want to have testimonies of faithfulness. We want our lives to be testimonies of God working in the midst of our lives, with our issues and failings, with the things we do right, the things we do wrong. And I think what is beautiful is that God wants to use each one of us uniquely. He's given each one of us unique gifts and talents. We all have unique callings in the things of God's kingdom. And the only thing that really matters is that you and I endeavor to encourage one another to fulfill the calling that God has on our lives. We see Moses fulfilled his. He ran his race. He ran it to win the prize. He forgot those things which are behind, and he pressed on for the high calling that was in Christ. As the Apostle Paul explains to us, the book of Philippians. And I want us, as the family of God here at Crossroads, I want all of us to fulfill the calling that God has on our lives. At every step of the way, Moses simply responded to the Lord. He saw that burning bush and he turned aside. Voice to take off your sandals, it's holy ground, and he took them off. God said, I want to do a work. Moses said, okay. He had his own issues. I can't speak. Just all these issues he had. But he walked with the Lord and God did a work. And I wonder how many of us tonight, like Moses, you understand what your struggles are. But because you're looking at your struggles, you're not remembering that God loves to leverage our struggles and do an amazing work. Because when he takes someone who doesn't feel like they belong to be there, he gets all the glory. So no matter where you are today, no matter what the issues are, yes, you're imperfect. But God loves to use imperfect people to do the most amazing things. Because when it happens, you're just like, they're like, wow, what you did? Whoa, I didn't do anything. I don't even know why I'm here. But God's doing something. And that's the testimony of every biblical character. Except for Jesus. Jesus, the only perfect one. Everyone else is just a grace case who God does amazing things when they say yes. So brothers and sisters, let's remind one another that as servants of the Lord, our only job is to say yes. That's our job. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Shall we bow our heads and our hearts as we pray together?